The Olden World, written by Czar Yoshi. Chapter 237. Last Rendezvous. By the time Howe touched down, gasping for breath and nearly tipping over under Maple's weight, the bandit Fred had already been dealt with. A smug Gerardo stood, the tip of his sword embedded in the ground, next to a pile of five magically incapacitated bodies and a mound of recovered plunder. Constable Coldstone, despite being on hoof, had somehow beaten Howe there. "Was that it?" Maple asked, pacing carefully up to one of the bandits, feeling exposed without her extra weight. "Just these five? I was expecting an army." "Well, bandits do tend to work in smaller groups. There's a balance that must be struck between strength in numbers and sharing the fruits of one's thievery, after all. Though, I think you'll notice that these are no ordinary bandits." Maple sized them up a second time. They were all stallions, all hornless, and all wearing masks and clothes that bordered on triggering a memory in her brain. She knew she had seen them before. "That spirit garb," Coldstone interrupted, "is what they use when out raiding convoys. Looks like they really were just out to get what they could, hiding behind the rhetoric, now that push comes to a shove. A pity. I always hoped they'd turn out to be better at the moment of truth." "Oh," Gerardo interrupted him with a talon and a smirk, lifting his sword. "They merely have a shared interest in concealing their identities. That is what these robes are for, are they not? Observe." With a flash of black metal, his sword bisected a stallion. As usual, it passed harmlessly through flesh as if made of thin air, but the bandit's garments were another story and were cleanly severed without the slightest hint of resistance. Gerardo beamed, pulling the ruined fabric away with the tip of his blade. "What do you call those, my good lord stallion? And how many real members of the spirit do you know that have them?" Maple's eyes widened. Through the torn robe, it was plainly visible that the bandit was a Pegasus. Constable Coldstone gaped. "What? They're with a defense force? Unspeakable!" His brow hardened and he stomped toward the fell Pegasi. "Deliberate impersonation or not, how dare you come to pilfer from a town as its citizens are being evacuated? You dirtbags are the one who started this whole thing. Don't tell me you want us to leave just so you can rob our homes."
"This is what we were afraid of," Gerardo sighed, stepping closer to Maple. "That the entire point of them forcing us into an evacuation could be no more than a ploy so they could fly into the unguarded areas and take something of supreme importance. Regrettably, it seems such banditry is going to happen, whether intended or not."
"It can't be intended," Maple protested. "If they were doing it deliberately, they would have waited until everyone was gone, right? And they wouldn't have been so easy to capture. They wouldn't have wanted to alert us to what they were going to do, at least if they're anything like the villains in the books I've read, but why would they go about it like this if their goal was to steal things?"
Gerardo tapped a talon. "All perfectly valid points. All perfectly valid points. I'm almost wondering if..." He blinked. "I say, where's Howe?" A beckoning whisper came from around a corner. Maple and Gerardo looked, seeing Howe pressed against it, carefully out of sight of the stunned bandits. He waved a hoof, beckoning. Gerardo waited until they were out of sight of the Pegasi to speak. "Have you something important to say?"
"I recognize some of those dudes," Howe's stage whispered. "They're all bundled up, but you can't hide from the Howenator. And those are Pegasi from my mercenary company."
"Well, that explains quite a bit." Gerardo hung his head. "If they're mercenaries in direct employ of Herman and capable of going behind the defense force's back, then impersonating defense force operatives impersonating the spirit would be quite a devious double ruse. As would it explain why they were so easy to take down. We could very well be looking at an attempt to frame the Stone District for a crime they did not commit, which unfortunately fits all too well with our previous theory that the true mastermind's ultimate goal is simply to bring these two districts to blows." "What kind of mercenary would allow themselves to be deliberately captured?" Maple asked. Howe shrugged.
"Oh, the chances of several unicorns laying in wait to teleport them to safety should events take a turn for the bleak are astronomically high. But as long as they remain captive, yet not in danger, they'll probably just leave them."
"Previous theories and true masterminds, huh? Mind saying all that again?" Everyone jumped. Maple's landing was particularly unsteady, since she hadn't been expecting how high she would fly, but she eventually caught her balance,
to see Shinespark standing in a nearby doorway. She gasped, "What are you doing here?" Shinespark nudged her short mane out of her eyes. "I've been everywhere today. There's a lot to get done. Speaking of which, it looks like you've been out doing a lot more than you were supposed to be planning." She narrowed her eyes. "I'm glad to see you didn't bring Starlight, but please don't take unnecessary risks. You two are important." Maple tried to offer a defense, but was beaten to speaking by Hal. "Oh, wow!" The Pegasus rubbed its forehooves. "I remember you! Yes, my superior intellect has dredged up a memory from the depths of time itself of... He scratched his head, drew a blank, and suddenly lit up. "Aha! You were there the other day when Valet was throwing fruit in my head. The Sosin boss lady. Truly, the Howinator is indebted to you for..." He was silenced by a sapphire glow around his muzzle. Scheisberg's ears were folded. She took a step back. "First off, slow down. You're kind of creeping me out. And if this is going where it usually goes when ponies say stuff like that, sorry, but you're not really my type." "As I was trying to say..." Maple cleared her throat, glaring at Hal. "We've been trying to take care of our own friends and staying out of trouble as much as possible. Right now, Starlight should be with a friend of mine at one of the Grand Acorn evacuation places. We're going to get her on our way back once we're... done with what we came to Copswood to do." Shinespark eyed her and nodded. "Okay. Anyway, it sounds like you've been doing some digging of your own on what we're up against. While I'm here, is there anything I should know?" She glanced at Hal. "And should we talk... you know..." Hal mimed something, lips still sealed by Shinespark's sapphire aura. "The short of it is like this," Gerardo explained. "Our associate Hal here is an ex-member of a mercenary company apparently employed by Ambassador Herman, strictly designed to operate behind the defense forces' back and undertake missions increasing the tension between the Earth and Stone Districts. Yesterday, there was a resolution to an incident involving Blue Leaf's power generator that turned out to be a mercenary member posing as a spirit operative to drum up anti-Sky District sentiment over blackouts he himself was secretly responsible for. Additionally, just now, around that corner, I apprehended a group of so-called bandits engaged in acts of pillaging who we believe to be mercenaries posing as Defense Force Pegasi posing as spirit members. As such, we determined Herman not only to be the ultimate instigator of this conflict, but actively working towards seeing the sides come to blows. Additionally, it is very likely he is manipulating the Defense Force the same way he's done for us." Shinespark paled. "That's... not good. I've already been trying to arm the spirit to incapacitate, not kill. But this probably means Herman will be at the dam himself to prevent us from talking things out and reaching an understanding and..." Her ears flattened fervor. "You were talking about Nia Nova, right? I knew him. I talked to him several times and I didn't catch this. It's very likely we have a spy somewhere who's been watching everything we were planning. I think our conversation this morning was safe, but... She straightened up. "Thanks for letting me know. Unfortunately, this doesn't actually change anything because it makes it even more likely the bombs will go off if we sit back and don't show up. But if Herman is expecting us, I don't know what we can do either." Gerardo grimaced. "I'll see you around," Shinespark said, releasing Hal and moving to leave. "I have work to do. For now, I don't have much of an idea what it'll accomplish beyond saving lives. Take care of yourselves, and whatever you do, make sure Starlight is at the safe place by nightfall. I just hope things will be..." What? A huge golden form slammed down on the dirt road next to them. "Yow!" Hal scrambled back. "Is that Brain Chick?" Shinespark turned, raising an eyebrow. "Brain? What are you..." Starlight peered down from the armor's back. "Hi," Brain said, crouching to let Starlight down. "She was at Rickshaw's hideout. Granada had brought her there after finding her in the tunnels. I thought it would be a good idea to bring her here." Everyone blinked. Slowly, Maple began, "You're not at the evacuation center? Or en route away from the tower where I left you?" Gerardo asked, raising an eyebrow. "Ha ha!" Hal grinned, ignoring the filly and rubbing his chin. "I knew you two ladies were in cahoots!" Starlight hung her head. "Sorry, Maple," she offered, coming closer. "They found a room for white chocolate, and me and Jam Jars were supposed to guard it. But she wanted to run off, and I didn't want to freeze her for that long, so I followed her to keep her from getting into trouble. But she went down to the basement, and there were power tunnels, and we wound up all the way here. There's another stallion who's supposed to be taking her back so the evacuation ponies can get her back with her mom, but I'm pretty sure the room we found won't still be open.
Gerardo winked. Well, in that case, I say no harm done. Miss Chocolate wasn't able to reach the tower in the first place and instead relocated to a warehouse, and they were going to bring you two to her. When myself and Hal returned to attempt to pick you up, your room was taken, so we assumed you had already left. And now, we're reunited here. Funny how that worked out.
Maple bit back a sigh of worry. Maybe I should have kept you with the cart.
Well, he is right, Hal pointed out. It seems the gang is truly reassembled, regardless of how it came to pass.
He grinned feebly.
Although, I would really appreciate it if I knew how you and they and you knew each other.
Family friends, Shinespark answered without hesitation.
So, Starlight, you're here now.
I am.
Starlight gulped, stood up, and immediately changed the topic.
Are you sure all those spirit ponies are a good idea? I wasn't there for long before Brain arrived, but they sounded like they really wanted to fight the Stone District, and they weren't listening to Granada. Didn't you say she was important?
They listened to me, Brain said, completely immobile.
Don't worry.
Shinespark rubbed the back of her neck.
Granada is special. She isn't in her position purely because of ability, but that's why we won't have her in the front assault squad. And remember, her job isn't to order around the spirit, but to be a better bridge between them and me.
We were wondering about something along those lines, actually, Gerardo remarked. Assuredly, I mean you no offense, but we couldn't help but notice your command team is on the younger side. Surely, that can't be optimal for getting jaded ponies to follow and obey.
That's what happens when the previous generation makes such a mess of things, Shinespark shrugged. If they won't leave the world clean for the kids, it falls to us to do that. Maybe, because we haven't lived through some of the things our parents have, we still have more faith in the world. But whatever the case, the ponies who are trying to make a difference here and now are just the ones who answer the call.
Excuse me, Hal barged in. So, you have my complete and total permission to educate me on what's going on the moment you get tired of me making wild guesses, but...
He wiggled one eyebrow.
As far as the intellect of the Howinator can discern, you, the daughter of Mobius, are balancing your duties to your district with a secret collaboration to lead a group of underground agents? A secret society fighting for a better tomorrow?
Shinespark shrugged and glanced at Brain.
Me helping to run the spirit of Sosa?
She shrugged again.
Pretty much.
Hal winked.
Of course. So, you fussily promoted your lover to a possibly disputable position as a personal favor.
My...
Shinsberg's brow furrowed. Then she stomped, glaring at Hal.
Granada is not my lover!
Hal merely waggled his eyebrows.
Gerardo blinked.
Interesting. I noticed you wore the same main style, but I presumed it to be more of an issue of...
She's... Shinespark gritted her teeth. I'm sure you all are aware of my father's... proclivities?
The alley... was silent. Eventually, Starlight offered,
So she's your sister, like Elise?
Half-sister, Shinespark said. She first tried to join the spirit several years ago. Brain and I like to do background checks to know what we're getting into with our members. It isn't always possible, but when you find a talented child with no record of their father, it isn't hard to want to do a little more digging and...
She shrugged.
I found out. We've kept an eye on her and tried to guide her over the past few years, especially Brain. And before you ask, she doesn't know, and I'll thank you not to tell her.
Maple blinked.
What? Why not? First off, Shinespark continued, I want to make sure my actions speak for themselves. She puts a lot of trust in me, and as much as I have to trust myself to keep from faltering under my burden, that kind of irrational faith from others makes me a little uneasy when I feel it in person. I'd rather the way she sees me be based on what I do and not colored by anything else.
She glanced at Hal.
Second, he's not entirely wrong. I think Renata does have a crush on me, and I'd really like to let it wear off naturally instead of... You know, I wouldn't want her to distance herself out of embarrassment either.
Well, oh, shrugged. There's always the possibility the knowledge could make her even more. Scheinsbeck's aura clamped back around his muzzle. Don't even think about finishing that sentence.
Howe nodded limply, eyes watering. Sighing, Scheinspark turned back to Maple, Gerardo, and Starlight.
I really do have to go. I know I've said this already, and I know you have things you want to do, and I'm not about to lock you up or imprison you, but this is important. Stay safe, especially Starlight. I'm trusting you to do this. I can trust you, right?
She raised an eyebrow. Maple responded with a forceful step.
I will keep her safe.
One last question, if I may, Gerardo interjected. The mention of spies came up earlier. Who all knows about the, more sensitive of secrets from this morning?
Right, Scheinsbach nodded. The place where we were? Everyone who was there, obviously, along with Dior, Matryona, Arambi, Mobius, and Dorable. The other factory chiefs were... Well, I needed my father's support for resources, and Dorable had something to contribute no other pony could provide. As for Brain, it's the same group, but those who know about Brain's brand are... Only myself, Dior, Arambi, and Dorable. And you.
She turned to go, then blinked.
Oh, and Valet knows everything. She's the only one who found out on her own instead of being invited.
Howe cackled softly into wing.
All these secrets are setting my fur ablaze with veritable lightning. So excited!
Yeah, well, Scheinsbach shrugged and lit her horn. Both of us very badly need to get going, so we'll leave you here. Stay safe and good luck.
With a flash of energy, she vanished in a burst of teleportation. A moment later, Brain crouched, jumped, and ignited her rocket booster, soaring over a roof and out of sight. The three remaining ponies, and one griffin, turned to each other and shrugged.
Well, I don't imagine our constable friend will miss our help in carrying those mercenary scallywags back to wherever he's taking them, he remarked. Shall we be on our way to the power control point?
Power control? Starlight frowned. What are you doing now?
Quickly, Maple explained their plan to rescue Valet, speaking in a hushed tone.
When she finished, Starlight's face brightened. Huh, I think I was just there.
You were? Howe looked up, wide-eyed. Perfect! My, memory of where exactly the place is might be slightly tarnished.
Maple snorted. Of course you didn't actually know where we were going.
Hey, it's not my fault, Howe protested as they followed Starlight's lead further into the city. Seriously, it's like these architects have no sense of style. I mean, maybe it's just me, but every building looks the same around here. You know? You know? You just can't blame a Pegasus for this.
End of chapter 137.